Nice to be here. It's a rather delightful surprise for me because I expected the Theosophical Society to be a kind of dowdy old building in the middle of Chicago from the 1920s, and I find this beautiful sanctuary and quite a vibrant community of people and lots of good programs. So I'm very much delightfully surprised, and I haven't seen John for 25 years, so that's really nice to see him doing well. And so I'm grateful for your invitation. I was going to change my mind about how I wanted to approach this talk because I saw the picture of a young Krishnamurti downstairs. It's in 1926, and his writings are very influential to me when I was in India. As a child, infrequently, once every 6 months or once a year, I'd wake up in the mornings to a different way of perceiving life, which was deeply silent and deeply compassionate. And I had no real way of, I mean, this is memory as a, you know, as a child, I don't quite know what was going on then, but the way it affected me was that I didn't know how to relate those profound morning awakenings to ordinary life, and I never really talked about it because that kind of discourse wasn't, I guess, available to me in my family, or at least that's what I remember. It's kind of many, many years ago. But what happened is it created a kind of very uncomfortable discontent throughout my life, not throughout my life, until I kind of got into meditation. But what happened to me is that that awakening was so perfect and so perfect that I had this deep yearning, deep, deep yearning to come back home or to realize that again, but I had no idea what to do with that. So I would get absorbed into the things that a child gets absorbed into, or an adolescent gets absorbed into, or a hippie gets absorbed into, and we won't talk about that. But anyway, all of those different avenues and things always kind of reached a point of, this isn't it. But it was never, there was no real positive, this is it. It was just that this isn't it. So it was quite a struggling kind of existence in that existential way. This isn't it, this isn't it. So I would get absorbed into things, and, oh, this might be it, and this isn't it, this might be it, this isn't it. And so, and then every now and then, there'd be the occasion of that. It always happened when I woke up in the mornings, and I could never repeat it willfully or deliberately. So then I had the same feelings in university. I went to University of Toronto, and again, this isn't it. And much to my parents' chagrin, I left, dropped out of university, and I just started to travel. I had longer hair, as you probably did too in those days. And I ended up in India, and I lived in India a year and a half. And during the early period of that profound time, it was a profound time in India, that kind of pivotal time in my life, I came across a book by Krishnamurti. And reading that book, I came to a conscious presence of that same way of awakening that I had as a child. And that was the first time that it was sort of a mature and conscious entering into that possibility. And it was, you know, it was like a whole day. So it was very, very, very profound. So finally, I had a lot of despair and searching and a lot of dead ends and mistakes and so on. There it was. And then the next day arrived and it was gone again. So I read the book furiously. But you know how it is, it doesn't work that way. And then I had a more mature sense, okay, then I understood, well, awareness, it's about awareness. Awakening is about awareness. And I realized that I didn't have a very disciplined lifestyle. So fortunately, about a month after that, I met an American who was a bhikkhu, a monk. And I got very inspired with monasticism, because I could see, well, monasticism would be a way of living a good life, but the focus of the life wouldn't be some material benefit or material success. It would be to be mindful and to be aware within this form, within this monastic form. And it struck me very powerfully. And I was surprised. I thought, if you would have told me a year before that I'm going to be a monk, I said, you're crazy. I want to have a good time. But I wasn't having a good time. So, and then I went to Thailand and so on, and I found that Ajahn Chah taught in a particular way, which was always encouraging the awakening of the mind. So coming here to the Theosophical Society and seeing the picture of Krishnamurti sort of brought that forward to me, that I could reflect upon that. As humans, we have this kind of paradoxical consciousness where we are both actors on a stage and we're also in the audience. We have both of those possibilities, don't we? Like I live in a world of responsibilities and relationships and an aging body with memories of time. I have a passport, I have to go through American immigration, then Canadian immigration. And so I act in the world, as we all do. But also, I can witness or be aware of my very acting. I can observe if I feel anxious in front of the immigration officer, or I feel annoyed that, because I came through Chicago a month ago, I have a very sad relationship with O'Hare Airport. This is recorded, so I won't mention the airline, but I took a particular airline from Ottawa to Chicago, from Chicago to San Francisco. And in the airport, I had a delay of 8 hours. And on and back and forth on the plane and so on. So I had a chance to both participate and be the actor in this O'Hare Airport melodrama, but also I had the opportunity to witness and be aware of my annoyance or my tiredness or the humor that was around me and so on. So we have this paradoxical consciousness, don't we? You know, I can both, and I have to live both realities. I have to both live and act in the world in a way which is both helpful to myself and others, or life is totally confused. But also I need to employ that reflective capacity, that capacity to not only feel my emotional world or remember things, but to notice, oh, the emotional world is manifesting in this way, memories are this way, perceptions are this way. And that part is really what I've used as a contemplative in my spiritual life, and I think that's the only thing you can use, it seems to me, is the mind which knows the way things are in a way where I'm not just always absorbed by the drama on the stage. Because if I'm always absorbed in the drama on the stage, I'm always taken by time, by objects, by my own personality. I'm kind of absorbed into it. And as long as I'm absorbed in the drama, I'm not available to something which I think is more profound and more deeply meaningful, and that's the silence and deep compassion of the heart, which to be realized, to be awoken to, let us say, one needs to be available. So if I'm constantly preoccupied with my own neuroses or my own hobbies or my own passions, and that's a kind of going out, isn't it? That's a going out into conscious experience. But I need to do that. I need to do that well, in fact, or the world of responsibilities and social relationships becomes overwhelming. And so the way I've learned Buddhism is that this teaching points to both of those, points to both the social life that I engage in and how to try to do that skillfully, and then that inner life of awakening to the processes of consciousness, and finding and discovering and awakening to that which is not just dependent on the processes of consciousness, which is something much more stable and peaceful and deeply compassionate. So in the training that I have undertaken and the kind of vocation that I live by, I have a very helpful structure, routine in the monastery. I live by quite a lot of different precepts and protocols because I live communal life. There's a lot of emphasis on speech which is gentle, speech which is harmonious, speech which is truthful. There's a lot of emphasis on simplicity of living, obviously not killing, not taking drugs which change consciousness, and so on. And those structures, those social structures, for me are not the goal, they're the method. So, say, one of the paradoxes, I think, in my own life, if I go back to my inspiration from Krishnamurti, is that, you know, if you're reading Krishnamurti, he was a bit of an iconoclast, and traditional religion, he could be quite cutting about it. So it's kind of a paradox. Here's this guy that gets inspired by Krishnamurti, and then he goes off and becomes a monk. Doesn't quite compute. But actually, what I found was that, you know, if I became a monk as an identity, I am a monk, as a kind of ego identity, then yes, that would be not honoring what Krishnamurti was pointing to. But not having a social framework and not having a stable foundation of living, that would also be just very confusing, very, very confusing. So I found this kind of interesting combination. And my teacher, Ajahn Chah, was very skillful at that, and subsequent teachers, very skillful at pointing out that this living of a good life, the living of a moral life, the living of compassionate existence, the living of a caring and a giving life is the method, but not the goal. So in Buddhism, we might say that compassion is the method. Forgiveness is the method. Generosity is the method. Nonviolence is the method. And why is it the method? Because those aspects of our social life are ones which are very freeing. Because like, if you think about generosity, if it was the goal itself, if that's the goal, that I should be generous all the time, then what do I do when I'm feeling mean-spirited? I feel guilty. You know, I'm terrible for having that. But if I make that the practice or the foundation or the doing of this life of awareness, then when my mind runs along avenues of meanness and holding and not being generous, I see that very much is always an engagement with all the changing phenomena of life. And that very engagement of meanness makes me unavailable to the transcendent. Whereas generosity, when I have more space, when I can give more, when I can offer more, I'm available. I'm available not just for service and so on, but also my mind has a certain sense of not needing, a certain sense of not needing to engage or get or compete and all that. And that lack of neediness, as it were, creates a mind which is available to something more profound. But if I made generosity and compassion the goal, then what I would end up, what would I do when I feel angry? What would I do when I felt just like bloody-minded? You know, actually, I'm not interested in you today. You know, leave me alone. I could feel very guilty about that. But if I see, well, that's just part of the drama, that's part of the stage, not to attach to that, but also not to make it a problem, to see that this witnessing or awareness or reflective consciousness can handle that. You know, I can feel fearful, mean-spirited, angry, but it's not a foundation for happiness. So it's not something I pursue. But I don't deny its existence either. And that was a very difficult insight for me to understand, because my tendency is to be very idealistic, and then from that attachment to idealism, very self-critical, and it wouldn't take much for me to really get on myself. My teacher, Ajahn Sumedho, the senior disciple of Ajahn Chah, he would say, Viradhammo, I don't have to criticize you, you just go for your own jugular all the time. You know, that just to accept the fact that this is in the nature of things is the teaching on is the reflective teaching, and then the reflective part of my kind of Buddhist contemplative life. We have, like, the way I look at the Buddhist path is, one is the social reality. That's the reality where I try to develop these good qualities as a foundation. But then the other, the reflective, is more like watching stream of consciousness. So, I'm in O'Hare Airport, and it's been 6 hours, 7 hours, and like I don't carry any money, so I don't have any money. So after 6 hours, and I walk by the pizza stand, I think, oh, that'd be nice. No way, there's no money. So that's the drama that I'm living through, right? But then if I look at it as flow of consciousness, right, and that way I can say, oh, this is a feeling, this is attraction, this is repulsion, this is an emotion. So I can look at life that way. I still need to get onto the plane eventually. I can't just kind of watch stream of consciousness and then just sit in O'Hare Airport the rest of my life. So there's the practical reality. But there's also this other way, isn't there? There is this other way of observing consciousness in a less personal way. And so some of the Buddhist teachings are trying to encourage us to say, well, like a very good book that Ajahn Sumedho has put out, which is Don't Take Your Life Personally. It's a brilliant title. It's a brilliant title. And you can see that, like, I can be, like, I have to take my passport personally. I can't take your passport. And if I lose my passport, I'll be in Chicago for a long, long time, maybe. I have to take it personally. But I can also look at anxiety, happiness, like, dislike, pleasant, unpleasant, as stream of consciousness events. I can observe that. And that second part is facilitated if the first part is clear. A person who is like living a very confused or inebriated or unfaithful lifestyle, their minds are just confused with those issues. But a person who lives a life of good faith, of good works, all those beautiful things, they have a kind of stability. They have a stability within which the second way, the reflective, contemplative part of our life can be employed, can be... it's a very interesting thing, actually, to be able to reflect on your own neuroses. It's a very interesting thing to look at how one's personality arises and ceases. Personality is interesting, isn't it? You know, when I see my personality operating, don't you always think, who is that guy? It pops, yeah, it reacts to something. So it's interesting. It's personality, but also the knowing of personality. There's the awareness of personality. And so the teachings that I've received from my teachers are very much encouraging this constant inner vigilance. Not inner analysis in some kind of narcissistic way, where I was just thinking about myself. You know, me, but more like just observing, actually taking out the me, and observing the stream of emotions and thoughts and ideas. And what we try to emphasize there is not the quality of the experience, but the observation of the change of experience. Now, that's interesting. If you, like in a social life, I have to observe the quality of the experience just to make sure I get fed and shovel the snow, and you know, I have to look at the quality of the experience. I have to deal with it. But when I am, if that's the only thing I have, and I only emphasize the quality of the experience, then of course my mind is always very much caught up in pleasure and pain. I like the pleasant, and I want to get rid of the unpleasant, which is natural. There's nothing wrong with that. But if that's the only option I have, the only option I have is always the objects of conscious experience, the sights, the sounds, the tastes, the emotions, the mental structures. If that's the only thing I have, then my mind is always preoccupied with this changing stuff. And what I don't tend to notice, or I don't emphasize, is the awareness itself. So I emphasize the objects, and desire does that, doesn't it? Desire emphasizes the objects. Get this one, get rid of that one. Like that, don't like that. We store it in memory. And there's nothing wrong with it. If you offer me a coffee, I'll take milk, thank you. Right? Don't like it black. So that's in the nature of things. But if that's the only thing, and it's very sad if I think that's the only thing, then my mind is continually trying to get it right. Kind of like as Ajahn Sucitta says, get rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic. You just never quite get it right, and the ship sinks, you die. But if I also say in the contemplative life, look and I observe, and this is the Buddha's recommendation, observe the changing nature of consciousness, of the phenomena of consciousness through the perception of change. Well, that's different. That's different. Because then what you have to do is you have to take your attention away from any particular experience and abide as awareness of the changing nature of experience. And what happens there when you do that, and this is a practice, it's not a belief. Like in Buddhism, we talk about change. Well, everyone knows, you know, winter is coming. It doesn't take a Buddha to tell you that. And then you need to put you put snow tires on here? Now, we haven't by law put snow tires. Anyway, that you need to get your shovel out, and you know, everyone knows the seasons will change. So, big deal. You know, it doesn't take a Buddha to figure that out. But actually to sustain the perception of change takes a very kind of accurate mind. You have to really stay with the moment. So let's say if I'm feeling I'm sitting in, we'll do the airplane, we'll do Chicago Airport. They load us onto the plane after I've waited 2.5 hours, then another 2 hours for lateness, they load us onto the plane. We get onto the plane, it's hot and stuffy, and the stewardess announces, we don't have a pilot. Okay, this is interesting. You got us all on board, no pilot. And we can't get the air conditioning going. And then she says finally, and we have no idea what's going on. Very reassuring. Okay, so I'm observing that, and it's getting hot, and people around are everyone is actually quite good humored, and the humor was great, but you know, people are getting uptight. Now, I can feel whatever that affects me. I can feel irritated or hot or annoyed or whatever, but to actually hold the perception of change as this event is taking place, that's not so very easy. I have to be mindful. I have to be present. I have to remember to take that perspective. But what if I do that? If I do that, I notice that, say that I'm feeling maybe agitated or not or humorous, and I hold a perception of change, that what I emphasize is the knowing of the experience rather than the quality of the experience. And this is very important, because if I emphasize the knowing of the experience, I begin to come to that which is the gateway to the transcendent, I should think. Which is the gateway to that deep openness and silence of the heart. But if I emphasize the objects of my conscious experience and only do that, then I'm kind of looking in the wrong place. I'm looking in the wrong place, because the objects of experience are very contingent, right? Very much depend on all kinds of other factors, and even though I get all the kind of ducks in a row and it feels good for a while, changes very, very quickly. And so obviously it changes very quickly, but is there an alternative? If there was no alternative, then I think just definitely maximize your pleasure and minimize your pain, right? Because that's the only thing you have. Eat, drink, and be merry, because you know it's going to be over soon. But there is more than that. There is more than just sense pleasure and sense displeasure. There is the awareness of that. And that awareness we don't tend to notice, or we don't usually, unless you're contemplative, cast awareness on awareness. And we don't usually. So like even as meditators, you're just trying to get peaceful. And we don't notice, so that peacefulness is a condition that comes and goes, and non-peacefulness is a condition that comes and goes. But when we cultivate the perception of change, and this is a practice, it's not like a belief. You can be a card-carrying Buddhist and say that things change but still suffer and not really understand it. So it's not a belief, but it's actually a perception that you have to bring up. Like maybe you give me some food and you'll ask me, is it salty? Is there enough salt? And I can have the perception of salty, can't I? I can notice, oh yes, salty, salty. In the same way, my mind can perceive change. But what I have to do, I have to let go of the fascination, or I have to let go of trying to find something and notice what is. Right? I have to let go of trying to find some particular thing and notice what is. And when I notice what is, then I awaken to the way things are. And as I awaken to the way things are, I notice the pull of all that, how discomfort pulls me towards comfort, how disappointment pulls me towards anger, how like I used to be really afraid of giving talks. I was like very afraid. I mean, I would panic and like go to the toilet 100 times or have to give one of these talks. Now it's just great fun. But to witness that as change is very difficult, isn't it? Because like it's okay to witness, like, you know, you're by the St. Lawrence River and you're just watching and listening to the changing sounds and abiding as a kind of witness of change. It's very peaceful and very nice. But then try to apply that to some of the difficult bits of our lives, the emotional negativity we experience, the disappointments in human relationships, the pain we experience with loss, the frustration we feel with people who are brutal or assertive or aggressive. You know, those are very, very hard things to take on. And so the training that we get as monastics is that the one of the things that Lumpo Cha would tell us a lot was you have to develop a lot of endurance. But not in, like, and he would say, not the endurance of a water buffalo, with lots of water buffaloes around. He said, water buffaloes can endure a lot, but it's the endurance of a contemplative. So what happens if I say, if I feel, let's say, okay, I'm living in the monastery, and I trust someone, and they do something to really disappoint me in a way which was not just a vague perception of mine, but they really broke their word, right? And I really trusted them. And that's very painful. That's very painful. It hurts, doesn't it? It hurts you. And to actually feel hurt and socially be responsible, to say, call them on that, fine. But to stay with the hurt and to stay with the hurt and to stay with the hurt until it ceases is very, very difficult. What we quickly do is, of course, run into blame. Why? Because we don't want the hurt. It's too painful to sit with that and bear that. And it's much more pleasant to hate someone and to feel the pain of that. I'm not talking about some kind of abject passivity where you can't say to the person, that's wrong. Just, you can't do that. Or you're fired. That's fine. That's the social realm. But that inner realm, you could see how the capacity to witness change in something painful takes a lot of patience. Takes a lot of training. And usually none of us get there right from the start. We blow it. We yell at someone or we do stuff. But we realize, oh, wait a minute, I'm caught again. I'm caught in the conditions of phenomena. And we begin to see the way out is forgiveness and compassion, not because I just want to be a goody-good person and I'm never angry. No, no. More profoundly, forgiveness and compassion release that attachment to negative emotions and make you available again to the transcendent. So it's a logical conclusion you come to, not just a idealized sense of what a goody good Buddhist is. All monks should always be nice. We should love everyone. We should never be angry, which is a horrible way to live. But just to realize that to hold resentments, to hold disappointments and so on, makes me unavailable. I'm preoccupied. So there comes a kind of insight from that how can I liberate my attention from this constant preoccupation with thought, constant preoccupation with emotional stuff and distractions? How can I be free from that? And the way to do that is to train the mind in meditation, but also to begin to perceive change. So let's say I feel some displeasure. If I feel like disappointment or displeasure, what my desire mind wants, right? It wants a replacement. It wants some kind of compensation. Okay, give me an ice cream. We have a friend in the monastery, not in the monastery, she's a friend of the monastery. She has a lot of kind of stuff that she works with, and she says one of the ways she compensates for that is by eating. So she feels down and go to the fridge. And of course, it's not good for her waistline. It's also not good for her mind because she's not processing this stuff. So one day she said she pasted onto her fridge, "It's not in here," which is brilliant, brilliant suggestion. So then to be with that, to be with like something disappointing, be socially responsible, but to be with something disappointing and witness it as change, what does it do? It lessens the desire for compensations. It lessens the need to go away from present moment awareness into a pleasant reality. And because that's lessened, what that strengthens is this sense of the awareness is my real home. And it can handle anything. It can be with anything. And it's that, it becomes like a change of, like initially the kind of default mechanism that we all have is to run away from pain and move to pleasure. That's natural. But after a while we see, yeah, that's useful at times. If I'm freezing cold, I better put a coat on. And if I'm starving, better get some food in me. Sure, that's useful sometimes, but as a constant strategy, it's very, very restless. And I come to that insight, that maturity, that if I forego short-term seeking of pleasure, I could realize long-term release from pain. And that's a very mature reflection, isn't it? And if I bear witness to this unpleasantness and pain now as change, if I can have the oomph to do that, if I can have the fortitude to do that, it has to be done with wisdom and the patience to do that, then the need to go anywhere else will cease. And the patterning of that tendency to react, to disappoint with anger, say, as example, the patterning will change too. And what will that do? That will free awareness. And I begin to see, awareness is my real refuge. Awareness of change is my real refuge. The conditions are unreliable. They're not bad. It's not bad. It's not bad to feel anger. It's just anger. But certainly it's not a place to hang out in. But also to think that life can always be pleasurable, and that's not a place to hang out either. So more and more one comes to the conclusion, to the feeling that, oh, great, thank you. You have more and more gratitude for the good times. But then when the other comes, you say, yeah, it's supposed to be this way. It's supposed to change. All that is unreliable. And that sense of abiding in the perception of change begins to open the mind to this awakening to silence, awakening to the transcendent. And I think the Nompocha, certainly, I'm sure you remember, I would go to our teacher and I'd say, oh man, I'm a basket case and I can't meditate, and your stomach upset and it's too hot and the mosquitoes are biting me, and I thought he'd give me some really kind of esoteric, deeply insightful instruction where I could get through this. He says, you have to endure. That was it. I said, this is the master. But he was right, because I didn't have the equipment to deal with the unpleasant and so on. Now, you could take that to the extreme and get into self-mortification and hurting yourself, but that wasn't the point of it. So, well, this is the situation. We're not forcing to be here. You can leave any time. It's quite benign. It's just uncomfortable. Oh, okay. So then I had to just develop like patience with heat. Patience, like lonely. I remember once, because I didn't speak Thai, and sometimes there was a translator, sometimes not. And I remember being in the hall when Ajahn Chah was giving a very long talk, and towards the end of the first, and so my concentration went after about 15 minutes, and he went on for about an hour and a half. Sitting on a concrete floor, no cushions, you know, nothing soft, and so my legs are hurting, my bottom is hurting, and I don't understand anything that's going on, the mosquitoes are biting, so it's a lot of negativity. And I'm thinking, oh, be quiet, will you? You know, that's the mind just thinking, I want to get out of here. I want to meditate. And then he started to crack jokes. I felt, and everyone was laughing, but I didn't know what they were about. I felt so lonely. I felt so homesick. And he would say, "What ton? Endure." You know, now that sounds kind of cruel, but no one was doing it to me. But that was really formative, because to be with a really benign situation, but emotionally very dry, shall we say, very difficult, was quite important to be able to, well, even this will change. So he kept emphasizing the perception of change. This is uncertain. And my mind, oh God, I can't take this, I can't do this anymore, I want to get out. No, this will change. And so through that kind of work, and that is work, isn't it? That is work. Through that kind of work and applying the mind with patience to that which is seemingly unbearable, the strength, you build a foundation and a kind of reserve which clicks into things so that awareness doesn't get overwhelmed. It's like now I took care of my mom for a long time in Ottawa, and I don't have much physical work at the monastery because I'm usually too involved with teaching and administrative things. So my upper body is quite pathetic. You know, I don't think I could do 2 push-ups anymore. And what that does, it creates a danger that if I have to grab something heavy, I'm not going to be able to hold it, right? So if I had some upper body strength, it probably, you know, it's going to be healthy for me. And it's the same thing with the mind. When I develop the capacity to be aware of something difficult, but not, you know, not cruel or life-threatening or wrong, not immoral, just life's inevitable difficulties, right? If I develop a capacity just to be with this, then it's like developing upper body strength, but strength of the heart, where then when life really comes at me in a way which, okay, I have to deal with this, I've got these reserves of patience, of generosity, of good memories, a mind which is free from remorse, and so on and so forth. And they help me go through life's travails, go through the ups and downs of life. And more importantly, the life's difficulties don't preoccupy me, and more I come back to the center, to my real home, and that possibility becomes realized, becomes more and more realized of deep silence, of deep compassion, not because I've willfully sought it as an object by getting rid of other things, no, because I've now allowed patience to operate, not attached to these things, perceive change, emphasize the knowing. Desire emphasizes the objects, the qualities of the objects, and the perception of change emphasizes the center of knowing, the center of stillness. And to get that means that the world no longer compels us so strongly anymore, because we become more interested, at least for me, it's my spiritual journey, that's what I'm really interested in, because I know that is where something more profound is possible. And then the other, yeah, I still, you know, if John took me to a nice restaurant and got me a cinnamon bun, that's fine, you know, it's not like you have to sleep on steel spikes or things like that. It's not a dismissal of beauty or joy, it's just seeing its limits. And you can be grateful for the beautiful things of life, but your real home, you begin to see, oh, awareness of change, which is a perception to keep bringing up. Okay, so there's some ideas on awakening. If anyone has any questions or comments, we can open to the floor.
If you do have a question, please just put up your hand and I'll bring you the microphone.
How does one go about starting a monastery in Ontario, Canada? Do you put an ad in the paper, or are there?
You have to be a bit crazy, first of all. Well, what happened to me was I've been involved in monastic startups a lot in my life. And I was living in, actually, in New Zealand in 2001, I think. And my mother, she was already in her 80s, and living alone, but my brother was in Ottawa. She fell and broke her pelvis. So I came out to take care of her, and then I saw, no, she's too old. So much to her surprise, I just moved in with her. Hadn't lived with mom since 69. And so then I took care of her, and she took care of me as best she could, you know, and for 9 years. And then she died, and she was 96 when she died. So that was very beautiful, beautiful thing to do for her, because I had been abroad and so on. And during that time, of course, I wanted to keep my Buddhist life going, and I had been going to Ottawa and teaching, so I had a good circle of friends, and I just suggested to people, is anyone interested in starting a forest monastery? And people said, yeah, let's go for it. So there was a body of people. And then we got some property, searched around, and a good friend, Ajahn Kuslo, came from New Zealand, and he was the senior monk. And then I would go on the weekends there. And that was that was the last 4 years of taking care of mom, and that was very important for me, because I was doing 24/7 on my own, so I was getting pretty tired. And that became a respite for me. And so mom died, and then Ajahn Kuslo went back to New Zealand, and so I've been there. She died in 2011, so I've been there regular now, yeah. I just have this karma of building monasteries. But it's an interesting, you know, it's like this place. It provides sanctuary. It's a kind of, Buddhist monasticism is a counterculture, but it's not anti-culture, because it has its sort of own economy, an economy of gifts, as one teacher says, based on generosity. People can come, and there's a training situation for men. It's a sanctuary where people can come and join in. So it creates a different kind of a culture, but it's not against consumer culture, other cultures, and so people can step out of their own lifestyles, join us, and then go back. And so it's a kind of, I've always found it a nice social offering. You know, this is my social activism, rather than being active in ecology or things like that. I found this is a very pragmatic, because it also served my interests, and also just to, like, I find quite rewarding offering a few men chance to train in values which are hard to live by in a competitive culture. So that's nice. So we have like one chap from Toronto, he's 24, and he's got very, very sincere, and to actually give him a space where he can develop those qualities, that's a nice kind of offering. Yeah. And my mom, she's very generous to the monastery, but in her last year, she was so fed up with living, you know, she was tiny by then, osteoporosis, a lot of pain, you know. So she's just, get me out of here, whatever, kind of feeling. And then she saw that the monastery was doing quite well. She says, oh, maybe that's why I had to hang on, to get the monastery going. So that's a nice, for me, a nice perception of the place. Any others? Yes.
In daily activities, when we play both roles of witnessing and also participating, like you said, patience is the practice we go through. But in that process of practicing patience, our mind comes in and say, you are being too patient, get involved and act. And while witnessing saying is, be patient. So there is a, even witnessing allows the part of me participate while witnessing or turn to patience and not do anything. So there is a tendency of being over patience, a tendency of being over participating in the melodrama. How do we play the balance of not over patient or not over involved in the melodrama?
Thank you. Yeah, good question. Well, for me, I'm very lucky because I have quite a defined lifestyle. So in my defined lifestyle, I'm a senior monk and I have responsibilities and I have quite a crisp definition, social definition, in terms of the rules that we live by. And that gives really good boundaries for reflection of what I have to do responsibly, what I can't do. And then also my job description kind of defines things for me. So I use that arena as my place of activity, my place of expression, my place of using my hands and my place of craft and my place of the heart, right? And that's the game I play. And then within that, I try to notice a patterning of my own mind. So like with responsibility, I use responsibility, and that's a very active thing, but I try to use that contemplative mind to see where, with, say, responsibility, am I passive out of fear? Where in my responsibility am I active out of aversion? So it's like admonishing, right? As a senior monk, one is asked to train in junior monks, so that's why they come there. And certainly I can be critical from annoyance, and I can be passive from fear. So I try to look at the roots of my fear. I try to look at my passivity or my inactivity, or I try to look at the roots of my activity. So let's say I'm getting kind of into some project and I'm getting absorbed, obsessed with some, like I'm trying to do some furniture making right now, making a Murphy bit, great fun. So I get, you know, obsessed with that and I don't meditate. Right? Okay, why am I being active? Oh, the monastery needs a Murphy bit. Sure, right. Give me a break. You just want to meditate. So if you look at the roots of passivity and activity, then it's not a position for or against. It's seeing, yeah, like let's say just wanting people to like me. So, you know, in the past I backed off on admonishing because I want people to like me, but the result's not good for me, for him and me, or the situation. So I found that the more I can listen to that part of my mind and kind of get the ego out of the way, then I find more and more there is a spontaneity which is wholesome, but not impulsivity, you know, which is just the craft of living a good life. And because, you know, we do a lot of sitting meditation, so we have we meditate from 5 to 6:30 every morning, and then we have an evening meditation for an hour and a half, and then we also have retreats. And I, you know, meditate my kuti too. That part of my life, which is very much a stopping, gives me a good mirror to show me what have you been doing in the day. You know, how is your activity or inactivity actually? What's that producing in your own mind? So there's a kind of constant, not intellectual evaluation, more like instinctive evaluation of how I'm doing in that social situation. So I mean, I have very good social situation for that kind of reflective. If I was in a very competitive situation, you know, and there's a lot of backstabbing, and you know, I might lose my job, and you know, there's a lot of layoffs. Boy, that'd be tough. That'd be really, really tough. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's why I became a monk. The pay's not great, but no, that's all right. Anything else?
I had a question about the awareness of change. Now, I know a lot of times inner dialogue is something that I want to settle down, but if there is an inner dialogue during an awareness of change, I'm wondering what it would be like. Like, would it be like a hip pain is arising, it's increasing, it's decreasing, oh, it's gone?
I do it before conceptualization. So I drop the inner dialogue. So, I mean, because I'm more interested not in the description, because the description is still an object. I'm more interested in the awareness. So if I'm always conceptualizing the phenomena that are taking place, then I'm still absorbed into an object, which is thought. But if I have a much more receptive attitude, so I receive the feeling in the hip, and then I watch should I move, should I not move, as a feeling, how much more time, as a feeling, then that takes me more to the knowing of change. Whereas if I engage with it with conceptualization, it's just me analyzing it and all the pattern that comes from that. Not to dismiss the need for conceptualization, otherwise it'd be a moron of some sort, right? But to see that it's very, overdone for me, all the thinking mind. So to come to the silence of being aware of change is a very present, it's like if you listen to sound right now, and you perceive the changing nature of sound, to perceive the changing nature of sound, you have to be silent. If I'm making comment, is that a fan? It's probably a fan, yeah. I wonder why they have a fan here anyway. Yeah, I'm not perceiving change. I'm just a self making comments about change. So I like to use, to train in that. I like to use body awareness a lot. I like to use sound a lot. Sound, I find very, very effective. I found, because sound is a very, listening is a receptive quality, and desire is a very grabbing kind of energy in me. So when I come to just listening and being receptive, then that sense of being availability to change is very, very easy, very easy. Bodily feeling I find very, very interesting to witness to the body as a changing phenomena of sensations rather than as a lump defined by concepts. My knee, say in body awareness, what I do is I try to take like a whole body awareness and get a feeling of the body as a mass of change. Get out of the head of trying to see the knee, see that, conceptualize it, and actually see the body as a vibratory thing. That really takes, that's very helpful for that knowing of change. Yeah? So I think disengaging from a lot of that thinking is quite important for me, because that very moment, it's very hard to do because we're so addicted to thought. And so then the struggle becomes of one of not getting rid of thought, but also not buying into thought. And that's hard, because if you're meditating, and the mind starts to babble on, you say, oh, shut up. You meditate more fiercely, and it doesn't work, because it's all willpower. So to actually have the subtlety to perceive the end of a thought, what does the end of a thought feel like before I jump to the next thought, brings you to the silence of the mind. And then to take sound and say, and within that, what's the sound like? But not to put commentary into it. You can ask, as soon as I ask a question, what's the sound like, and you describe it, but that's not the point of it. It's just to bring you to pure attention and so on. Then if thought is obsessive, then I try to get to the root of the obsession. I try to get to the root of it physically. So let's say I'm obsessed about worrying about the finances of a monastery. The abbots do this all the time, right? Who's going to pay the bills and so on, right? And so that maybe, not recently, but if that starts to obsess the mind, then that's driven by some emotion, and that emotion has a physical correlate. So if I do whole body awareness and I identify, oh yeah, this worry. So I have enough analysis, worry feels this way, but then I open myself to a kind of receptive, allowing, okay, so what does it really feel like to worry? I make fully conscious the feeling of worry, and I go to the perception of change. Then quite often it comes through the body, it manifests, feel the tension in the guts or in the heart. Heart's very important. That manifests and then releases itself. Because I've been able to stay with this as perception of change. Because I found that thinking about it wasn't all that helpful. Because then I was just sort of reinforcing it, trying to get rid of it and so on. So there, that's where the patience comes in, to actually trust in the physical manifestation of something that will take care of itself. So making things conscious, I think, is a very important aspect of my contemplative life, like making disappointment conscious. What does it feel like to be disappointed? Rather than, oh gosh, I'm disappointed again. Like let's say, like meditation, sometimes, you know, a monk will feel, I've got it now. And then you go, oh, I've lost it now. But both of those are just feelings. That's all they are. But obviously, one feels better than the other. It feels great to think you know something, because especially if you teach, and it feels terrible when you don't, you know. But actually, they're the same. One's a feeling of confidence, one's a feeling of non-confidence. And you find, the awareness of that is neither confident nor lacking in confidence. It's transcendent. But if I can remember, confidence is uncertain. It's uncertain. And when it changes and you start to feel lack of confidence, that's who it's supposed to be, your freedom. Your freedom. And so body awareness, full consciousness of what is manifesting, that those things are very, very helpful. Then you're not threatened by anything. Let it come. Let it come out. Let it be conscious. Nothing can really hurt you. That's at the flow of consciousness. Don't stand out in the traffic and do that. You're toast. Okay? Yeah.
You talked about the power and inspirational quality of some of the infrequent awakening experiences you had spontaneously as a child, and at the same time, the difficulty of replicating those in a considered way. And even when you were pursuing the path of Buddhism, you know, we were laughing about sitting on the concrete floor and just the difficulty of building endurance. I was wondering if you could shed a little bit of light on if there are any breakthroughs along that path where you finally were able to really bring some of those awakening experiences in a considered way, in a repetitive manner.
I would call my path the death of 1,000 stabs. it's the defeat of wrong understanding. So where wrong understanding, what for me is the pursuit of time. You know, that I'm someone who's unenlightened and I've got to beaver away, work hard, and at some point, future lifetimes, when I'm 64, now I'm 67, but I will be enlightened. So self, time, becoming, right? And the futility of that, when that became apparent, it was an important insight. I said, it cannot be a matter of time. So it wasn't necessarily like an epiphany of like, you know, chakras bursting open and radiating the ceiling, that kind of thing. It was more, that's not the way. So for me, it's been more like a dropping away. No, that can't be it. And then the stability of like concepts like timelessness, not a matter of time, whereas desire is always a matter of time. Then just in terms of I think the realization of emptiness when you're sitting, you're meditating, and you're not grasping, and all of a sudden the sense of self falls away. And there's just pure perception. That's significant. And it might just be like a little thing, but no. It impacts you on an intuitive level, which then processes through you, not through will, but because the heart's seen something now, which is profound. So the understanding of what we call emptiness in Buddhism has been very important. And then that coming to that again and again. So timeless, not a matter of time, here and now. Not a matter of self, me becoming something. And then also like the idea that any quality can be where it's at. So like just the quality of a peaceful meditation it's very tempting to think you've got something. And then the meditation is like haphazard. Oh no, I've lost it. No, but that changed. What didn't change? And so the very sense of a quality being somehow desirable. And so that is the letting go of the seeking of qualities, and that's where the patience comes in. Huh? So those insights come for me, have come through just a lot of trial and error, right? And then but then the insights are very, very solid, because they come from an existential experiment and a not just a belief, right? They come from, I tried this, that didn't work. Yeah, oh, why did, oh yeah. And then the insight is like the wisdom factor in the mind, the discerning factor is informed with insight rather than just information. Information, as Lompo Samhita said, information won't crack the puzzle. You know, even Buddhism has got a huge system of thought. But to deepen, you know, the ideas means it's like discernment and insight. So I've always been trained to work with suffering. So if there's some form of not rightness in my life, make it conscious. What's the problem? And the problem is always some misunderstanding that I want life to be other than it is, or I don't want the way it is. And coming to that conflict with the way things are and seeing, I'm trying to, like, let's say in my meditation, most monks early on, they're really trying, like, they're, you know, trying to get enlightened so fiercely that they have, well, not breakdowns, but I mean, I've really pushed myself a bit. Like, I those for early years, I was like pushing the sleep envelope. So I'm walking back and forth, and I was so tired, I'd fall asleep at the end of the walking path. But then I'd be so stupid, I wouldn't go to sleep, I'd start again. So I kind of pushed myself to get something called enlightenment, which was a delusion which everyone else could see, but I couldn't. Right? So I had to suffer through my own delusions, and then I'd hear the teacher, oh yeah, he told me that last year. Why didn't I listen to him? I couldn't hear it. I had my own willfulness. And this is like 40 years ago, right? And those very humbling but profound insights start to create the foundation for a mind which is doesn't seek anything, doesn't need anything. You know, it's letting go, not in an abject kind of passive way, but in a profound way that it's here already. That kind of a thing. And then within it, you know, you get brilliant moments and all of that. But it's more the solidness of those insights which creates this deep stability, which is intuitive. It's not just intellectual.
Thank you. Hi. And thank you for this beautiful lecture. I have a question regarding what you said about letting go of the frustration and not trying to compensate always with something else. I think for most of us in our culture, we try to fix things or make it better, and this. And I used to have a friend in my country that she, every time something happened, she had a good answer for that, because of it's gonna happen something better, because she always had an answer. Until one day I was very mad at her, and I was like, you just wanna make me feel good about anything, but you're not telling me the truth. This happened because of this. You're not being honest. And she was like shocked. And that was just the way she is. And she's very sweet. And I love her. I still love her. Now in my life, I think I see that this keeps happening to me and maybe to many other people, that we try to compensate. Okay, this didn't happen. And getting rid of that frustration And instead of going through, and sometimes we go through, but then we want to stop it. We have to put an end to it because it's too painful to always go through pain, I feel. And to me, meditation has helped me a lot, but it's still that daily life that things we can't control in the world and happen and give us frustration, pain. And how do we go through that? How do we compensate? Or not try not to compensate and just like, okay, I'm going to go through this situation. How long do I have to suffer this?
Right.
How long do I have to, and being a, I'm not a Buddhist or, but I'm trying to be a good person and I'm trying to have a good life. I'm not going to become a monk, maybe. But in
no, you have nice hair. You don't want to do that.
My aspiration is just to be good.
A good person, yeah.
Right.
Well, you have to be reasonable about what you can handle in life. You know, the kind of idea that you can handle anything can lead to burnout, right? So, I suppose it's what one's interested in. So if you're interested in the silence of meditation, that part of consciousness, you also get interested in what blows you away, right? What distracts you, what stirs you in a way where you're carrying it around for days. You get interested in that, but interested in a way where you're not just going to endure it because you have to endure it because it's some kind of moral, spiritual duty, because no, you're interested in now, why can't I be with this person in a way where I don't carry them around for 2 days afterwards? Because you realize, well, I have to carry this person around 2 days, you know how it works, right? Whatever, then I'm not available. I can't have access to the silence. So you begin to have much more discernment and intention around those areas where you do really get overwhelmed, where you can. And you make that your practice. So, like I had one situation where I was in a retreat center where the person who owned the retreat center was quite negative and would dump on me a lot. And it was benign. It wasn't life-threatening, but it was very confusing because he owned the center and I was living there. A bit of compromise. And he would come and he would say some really awful things about the meditators. It's a strange man. Yeah, but it's meditation. So I'd absorb it. So, you know, I'd listen, be the good listener. Yeah. Then I'd go back and I'd hate the guy. Out of all this garbage he just put on my mind. So that doesn't work. And then but all the time I was like, why can't you just listen to him? Why make it a problem? It's just venting. So then I'd go back and then I'd lose it and I'd yell at him. Then I go back and feel like an idiot again. It's just, but I realized, okay, there's something about this man that I can't remain receptive and not get overwhelmed by him. So I used him as my teacher. Didn't tell him that. And I just went back, and he'd dump on me again. And it took me a while, but then I began to see, okay, if I need to do some kind of a boundary mantra with him, right? So then I'd see him coming in one of his rages. Oh, here he comes again. And I kind of had to be there. And he'd start to vent. And then I just said, may you be well, may you be well, may, under my breath. May you be well, 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 may you be well. And he saw that I wasn't reacting. He saw that I wasn't reacting. And all of a sudden he stopped. So I wasn't buying into his stuff. And then I gave him a really good Dhamma talk. And he didn't go for me afterwards at all. Point being, it's not my success in this situation, but rather that it was something that I knew I could learn from, but it was something that I could learn from. You know, it wasn't overwhelming. I have been in other situations where I've had too much responsibility and I burned out. you know, where I couldn't be mindful. It was just so beyond my capacity to be mindful, the responsibilities. I just had to be shipped out in a box kind of thing, right? So it's not an absolute kind of a thing. So in any area of your life where you can bring more discernment and attention to the very reactions you're having, especially if it's, I find if it's repetitive, if you have someone in your circle of companionship or whatever, work, and there's one person who, you know, always gets your goat in some way, but they also, you know, it's not an immoral situation, you know, you just have to bear with it. You start to program your mind, okay, when I'm going to, rather than anticipate this confrontation kind of thing, you think, when this guy comes into my, or this person comes into my field of activity, I'm going to try to notice my guts, say, the tension in my stomach, or my heart chakra. What's that feel like? And you get more and more, you know, kind of adept at not just reacting, but seeing the reaction. Seeing the fear come up in the body, in the shoulders, in the chest, and seeing, breathing with it. You get adept at this situation. And then usually that's where you can give the best response. But more importantly is that you've learned, you've developed some of these strengths, which will then play out the rest of your life. You know, it's a kind of skill. So there's no answer to these, you know, the complexities of life. I think also that if life is very distracting and, you know, compensations are like too, you're getting too much into that, so retreats, periods of silence, periods of not filling the mind. Our culture just loves to fill our minds, right? We, you know, with the internet and all that. But to actually, like internet fasting. You know, it's a very important kind of fast to do. Yeah, really, just 1 day a week. I mean, that's like a radical possibility. 20 years ago, it wasn't even a question. Things like that, which give your mind a chance to rest, no input, they will get restless. This is interesting. If you fast, your mind will thinking, well, this is a stupid decision. But then you watch that restlessness of wanting to go out into compensation, say, and then, you go through the restlessness and you come to the peace. But there's a, you know, you gotta bear witness to it. I have a lovely simile I use a lot. It's a simile of a skin rash. Have you know what poison ivy is? Okay, so you've had poison ivy? That's not nice. So poison ivy, you know, you touch the plant, the acid in the plant goes onto your skin, and you get a blister, and it itches. Yeah. And what do? You scratch it, because it feels good. And if you've ever had a rash, you know, this is bliss. This must be nirvana. And you scratch it, and you feel good. You really do feel good, no doubt about it. Now your rash is twice as big, right? You get a problem. So then you think, okay, I will not scratch, not scratch, not scratch. And you're talking to someone. All right. I will not scratch. I will not scratch. Not scratch. Now you have unfulfilled craving coming up. The itching is still there, but you realize you need to make an investment in patience, and man, you're not going to have no skin anymore. And then you're in the shower, and you go crazy. And you know, it feels really, really good. And I said, no, I've really, and you start to make intentions and determinations around that habit, because it's going to be profitable to get rid of this disease. And you don't scratch it, don't scratch it, don't scratch it. And eventually, the disease ends, partially because, you know, that's a disease, and you put calamine lotion on someone. But it's a good analogy of getting past some of these things. Where you know, it's no doubt that if you follow that compensation, it will be pleasurable. That's why you do it. You don't do it because it's displeasurable. So you forego short-term pleasure for the long-term freedom from disease. And that's a kind of, obviously, it's a mature principle in life that we have. But it, you know, it takes, and when it itches, it really says, yeah, scratch me, man. This is important.
There's someone who sent a question online.
Oh, really?
Yes. Semantics aside, are love and compassion the same thing?
Yeah, semantics aside, love is a very difficult word in English because I love potato chips, I love my children, I love the mountains of British Columbia. So from my training and the way we talk about love in a kind of contemplative way, we talk about goodwill, and that's the interesting, because it's online, I want to look at the camera. Hello. Goodwill is the sense of not liking everyone, but not wishing them ill. I can do that. I can dislike someone's behavior and say, you know, may you be free from suffering. I don't have to hate them. So that's what we call metta in the Pali language, or just a sense of goodwill. And that I can cultivate. It's hard to cultivate, you know, if I have a neighbor that is, you know, just cut down my maple tree or whatever, right? Just goodwill to this guy, no way. I mean, but you see, no, if I hate this guy, I got to live next door to him. Not only is it an awful way to live, but also I'm not available to the transcendent. So goodwill, that goodwill is the basic kind of recommendation the Buddha is asking us to cultivate. So there's a difference between just getting angry at someone and hating someone. You know, someone does something, you know, I've just got a new car, and then I find that someone's tried to, you know, maybe taken a coin and just run it along the new paintwork. You know, I got a new Lexus or something, and someone's done the first feeling is going to be, oh, thank you. No, it's going to be, my Lexus. But I can say, well, if I just indulge in ill will, that's going to own me the rest of my life. This person's forgot about it. I say, forgiveness, goodwill. So that's a part of love, I would say. And compassion is the empathy I have for other people's suffering. So compassion is the feeling when the elderly person is trying to get across the street and the traffic is scaring them. I say, let me take you across. There's a lot of traffic here. Let me take you across the street. That's compassion, feeling for the pain of others and actually acting on that helpfulness. Then we have another attitude of empathy, which is love. It's the attitude of gladness, and that's when a person is successful or happy. And the example I like to give is like when a child comes to you, and the child's just done, a four-year-old's done a little piece of artwork, and you know the child's all happy and gives you the artwork, and you're really happy because the child's happy. You know, you don't say, the lines aren't straight. Sorry, kid, back to the drawing board. Right? It's more, good on you. It's a really heartfelt joy, isn't it? And that's the kind of love which comes from empathy. So it's an empathic. And there's a kind of love which is the acceptance of reality, I think, that reality has its ups and downs. And that's the peacefulness of mind, the kind of acceptance of the good, bad, and the ugly. And that's very important because we do feel all kinds of emotions, and to have empathy for one's own predicament, not to demand that we're always compassionate, but to be at peace even with our negativity seems to be a kind of a love too, you know, a kind of a acceptance of things. And there's all other manners of love. There's the passion that two people somehow they just have the chemistry between themselves. It's very mysterious why that works that way. There's like just like sexual passion, that kind of love. But in a Buddhist sense, that's quite often how we talk. We talk about those four things. So goodwill, empathy towards helping those who are suffering, gladness towards those who are happy and successful, and that kind of peaceful coexistence with life. Okay.
One last question. Okay. But I see you've got a list there, so...
Yes, yeah, don't sweat.
No, this gentleman's question kind of made me think of something I've thought of in the past, too. With Vipassana,
when you're witnessing things that going through your consciousness, you know, they have the idea of labeling, like, oh, thought, feeling, pain, you know. Do you do that? Do you advocate that? Or do you advocate, because even what I always thought of is even that's a concept, yeah, calling it something.
I've never done much of that.
Okay, that's what I was wondering.
I will sometimes, like, I'll just notice the patterning, and not even that, I don't. I just go to the body. Yeah, I was never taught that, and I never used it much. Obviously, there's some analysis goes on, right? You know, but I find just, it's much more immediate into the body. Because I know it's just stuff. And so I find actually just like dwelling more with the heart chakra, just living here more, just like just seeing the energy going up into thought, back to the heart. Just back to here. And that I find the place of most appropriateness in life's responses. Because if I abide there, I'm much more empathetic to life, and then my responses are from there. When I'm abiding with thought, which is necessary, but a lot of it is just the patterns of proliferation and so on. So I've just trained myself a lot in body awareness, especially heart chakra, stomach, tension, those kinds of things. In a way, not critical, just knowing, oh yeah, there it is, it's all tight in there now. Open that up, that kind of thing. A lot, yeah. I use the word receptive rather than focus. I like to think of it, I localize attention in a receptive way because, I mean, this is language or semantics, but sometimes just the word focus for me is like, you know, kind of screw up your eyes and really look at something. Not necessarily. So I just say localize and receptive. I find the word receptive very good because then it's not me trying to do something. It's allowing that part of the world to just manifest. Okay.